It's a very important issue, this. There couldn't be anything more important scientifically than really origins. I know the other areas of science are important, but really, if we're going to say that scientifically it's been proved that, there is no, there's no mind out there, then we ought to know about it. But I want to show you that the evidence is all the other way. The evidence strongly is pointed towards the fact that there is a mind, that there is intelligence, that we cannot in any way subscribe to the views of those who are strutting up and down this country saying that, there isn't a God. Science proves the other way. Now, clearly, you can't go very far with science on its own. You can't establish the character of God. You can't actually show much more than the fact that there is a mind. But it would really be ludicrous to suggest that the evidence scientifically is against that position. You may be agnostic, and I don't, in a sense, I still don't agree with that position, but at least that's a position which is a little bit more accommodating to the fact that there is an argument. But to say that the argument is spurious, it's actually putting people like Einstein, it's putting people like C.S. Lewis, who is a very great philosopher and thinker. You may not agree with all that C.S. Lewis thought, but a brilliant mind. And it's putting all these people as regarding them as fools. And it's saying people like Faraday, people like Newton, much greater minds before them, that these are just foolish thinkers, and that somehow we in the 21st century, we know better than them. It's such arrogance scientifically to say that. And I want to put my position very much up front and to say that the science actually is not for this argument, as some people are saying today, that, the science has proved that it's foolish to think that there is a mind behind the universe. It's totally the reverse. The science actually presents a very strong argument that there is a mind behind the universe. It doesn't go much further than that. One of the most ridiculous questions I get faced with is when people genuinely think that it's a serious question to say, well, who is the designer? As though somehow to bring God into our thinking is false scientifically. I want to show you that it's anything but false, that it fits beautifully with the evidence. Now, I'm going to present arguments for design on the top level, then I'm going to come down to a little bit lower in terms of more micro level, and then I'm going to end on the level which is really to do with molecular and information. Now, I have a separate talk that I do on thermodynamics and information. I'm not doing that talk tonight, but maybe in the future I will do that, because actually that's a very important coupling. But it really takes two lectures to get over this point about information. And it really takes that, if you really want something which goes in depth, perhaps I'll do that at some point, but there is a connection between thermodynamics and information. But I'm just going to touch on information at the end. Let me then start at the top level and just do a little bit more of an introductory nature. Evolution, I'm taking not as what some people call microevolution. Evolution, I'm taking as here defined to mean molecules to man, okay? Protons to prime ministers, right? Or molecules to man through magnolias and all the rest, okay? But we are talking here about the macro view that somehow some slime and some mud 4.5 billion years ago, gradually became creatures which we have today. And even before that, the idea that 10 billion years ago, lots of stuff got together and gases and collapsed down and formed a star, and then from that came the solar system. That's what I'm taking as the story of evolution. I'm not therefore talking about variation, which clearly creationists do accept. We don't believe in the fixity of species, as some people build straw mans of our argument. We're not of that view. We know that there are changes. The point is that those changes do not build bridges between mice, melons, and magnolias, and all the other elms. Okay? There is no connection. God made things differently with the ability to change within certain bounds. Scientific experiment actually indicates that codes and order come from intelligence. That's what I want to show you on the science. Now, I've brought up front what really my position is. I'm clearly a Christian. I believe in the Bible. I believe that God made the world. And if anybody asks me on the media, I'm quite up front to say that's my position. But scientifically, it fits with that position. That's what I want to show you tonight. And you might say, well, you still haven't really proved from the science who God is. You haven't proved that the Bible is true in every respect. Well, fair enough, I haven't. But I will have shown you, I trust tonight, that it's a very legitimate position to take that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And that the evidence today shows it. That's the aim of my talk tonight. Evolution says that primitive life forms come to people by natural selection. That's what evolution, according to the definition I've just been using, is stating. Whereas the design position, which is the position I take, says that there was complex earlier kinds, essentially dogs, essentially cats, essentially human beings, essentially monkeys, different to human beings, essentially all other creatures like dinosaurs, different types of dinosaurs, and God made all of these. And natural selection, which is no problem for a creationist, no problem whatsoever, has actually operated on those creatures and provided some variation. But natural selection, according to my position, is no engine to change things dramatically across barriers where, you know, there is no information in a mouse to become an elephant. Okay? That is basically the position of the creationist. We have no problem with natural selection. Natural selection, you'll see, is in both definitions. And it's important to realise that. Because many people, on the media in particular, like to put it that if you do believe in natural selection, you obviously believe in evolution. And creationists obviously don't believe in natural selection. Nuts! Rubbish! These arguments are totally misrepresenting the position of the creation thinking people today. Now, I do admit that in the past there have been some who have perhaps given the wrong impression as to what the creation thinking is. But when you go into it carefully and define your terms carefully, you will see that that is not held by most thinking people who are in the creationist camp. Now, machines, I'm still really on my introduction, I will get going, but machines require a designer. That's my position. And clearly, as an engineer, when I look at an F-18 banking in a massive high G turn, and I see all the condensation coming off it, and I can tell you all about the thermodynamics of that, but that tells me that this is a machine made by men, who actually were clever people who put it together. In exactly the same way, we look at natural systems and we see design. So macro design in nature. Let's have a look at an example of bird flight and breathing. Here's some Arctic terns, which are flying from one pole to the other. On the other side is a fan-tailed pigeon. These are incredible examples of macro design. I have another talk, which I think you filmed earlier, where I went into a lot of detail, I'm not going to go tonight, on birds. But briefly, some aspects of birds which really indicates design are their hollow bone structure. All except the loon bird have this. The loon bird's in Canada, it's a diving bird, doesn't have it to the same extent. Has it only on certain bones, but most of them are in fact solid because it's a diving bird. Now, the avian skeleton is really built with an attention to detail of design. For instance, that which is really only common to birds is this massive breastbone structure. It's called the sternum bone, and this is the keel of the sternum. Then there's this famous wishbone, which we always have a go at Christmas. basically, you flip that whole structure over, and that's what you're carving against your Sunday dinner. It's the keel of the sternum bone. Sorry to disappoint you with all these interesting facts. But just, I want to home in on that sternum bone, because that sternum bone supports some very important muscles. It's also relevant to breathing, which I'll come to in a moment, because a bird doesn't have a diaphragm. It moves the sternum bone. Now, this sternum bone has two muscles which come up. One of them comes up and over, and the other muscle, which is the major muscle, is similar, yes, to mammals like ourselves and reptiles, which is, and it's called the pectoralis major muscle. So far, so good, except that this other muscle we don't have, and neither do reptiles. This muscle comes from the keel of the sternum, so we're looking end on down the breastbone here, and it comes up through, threaded through an opening in the coracoid structure here, and we have what's called a supracoracoideous muscle, supra because it comes up and over, and it lifts the humerus bone. Now, I talked about this last time, but I'll just remind you that if I was to put Mark Surtees on this table, he would have great difficulty. You might like to try with him afterwards. Everybody gang up on Mark and try and lift his arms. He will screech at you because he won't want it to be done. This movement going up is something that neither a reptile nor a mammal like us would wish to do. It, though, is very easy for a bird to do. The reason being, there is this supracoracoideous muscle which is yanking the humerus, which is this bone, it's yanking it back. Okay, so if you're thinking of the bird like that, it's going up and it's making the wings touch even at the top with ease. So a bird has a very important muscle arrangement. Other creatures like ourselves also have this major muscle, this muscle going across the breast here. But the supracoracoideous muscle is different. Now, the reason why I mentioned that sternum, it's very important for the muscles. It's going to be very important also for the breathing. You'll see in a moment. When we breathe in and out, and we draw air in, and we push air out. I hope you're doing it tonight, because if you're not, there's only one solution to you being here. You must have been carried in, or else you've died after you've heard me speaking. Right? But basically, you've got to be breathing in and out in order to keep the oxygen going through your body. So the oxygen comes in, it comes in with the air, 21% roughly of the air is oxygen, and it's transferred across to the bloodstream, and the carbon dioxide then filters through back into the tubes there, which then are connected to the trachea and the bronchial tubes, and the air is breathed out again. Now, this is what is interesting about birds. Birds don't have that arrangement. Whereas we have bronchial tubes, and these small little tubes I refer to are alveoli, not ravioli that you had for tea tonight, but alveoli, then birds don't have anything like that. They have a continuous mass exchanger, which is drawing the air in from one side and carrying through the air to the other side without stopping. That's the crucial point about bird breathing. The blood is coming from the right to the left, and the air is going from the left to the right. So it's actually a counterflow mass exchanger. The air is coming in from left to right, and it's never stopping. The blood similarly is going from right to left. As the blood comes in, it gives off the carbon dioxide such that the air going out picks it up on the way out and takes it out. As the blood leaves the mass exchanger, it actually takes in the oxygen, and it is enriched before the blood leaves the lung. It is a counterflow mass exchanger. All engineers know that mass exchangers obey the laws of diffusion. It's the laws of diffusion of mass through the membrane into the blood, and the gas obeying the laws of diffusion back into the air. Okay? Those laws of diffusion are well known. We know that we can set them up as a second order differential equation. If you want to know all the details, go and look at the books or come to some of the lectures I used to do. They've stopped me doing them. Not that there's any reason why they've stopped. Just I've moved on to other things. But I've still got the notes if you want them. But, you know, okay, we can go into all the maths of the diffusion of air. And when you crank the handle of all the mathematics, okay, it's very similar, by the way, to heat exchangers. Exactly the same principle, except you're dealing with heat diffusion when you're dealing with refrigerators and all these other continuous flow systems. All engineers know that mass and heat exchangers actually are built according to how efficient they are or for what their application is. Now, get this. The most efficient exchange system is always a counterflow system. By most efficient, I mean this. To get as much diffusion for a given system without building too much weight into it, right? Too much mass, in other words, you need a counterflow system. If you have a parallel flow system, you still get the same idea, but it would take more mass to get the same amount of diffusion across, right? Now, why is it a counterflow system? It's obvious, because weight is critical when you've got something which is flying. Now, it will mean that there are possibly other limitations because you may be a bit cramped for space and there are other factors to consider here. Well, that's why there is an incredible system of tiny little tubes. This is nowhere near the complexity, really, of the lung. The avian lung is full of tubes which are so small, if the air was to stop going through them, they would collapse and they would never be reinflated. When your budgie next dies, right, don't try to resuscitate it mouth to mouth. It will not work, okay? You can't sort of push on the belly. You know, it won't work because you cannot inflate the lung of a bird. When it dies, that's it, folks. That's the end of that budgie. Or that's the end of that bird, whatever it might, pet bird that you've had. So, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but birds cannot be artificially resuscitated for this reason. So birds have an incredible lung. Now, you might think that that's it. That's not the end of the story. If you thought that was complex enough, get this bit. Because we haven't yet finished as regards the avian lung. The avian lung doesn't operate in the way that our lungs work. That is, we breathe in and we breathe out. Oh, no, no, no. Because it's got to be a continuous flow system. So when you breathe in, or if you're a bird, right, supposing you're a bird, and you breathe in, the air does not immediately go into the lung. The air goes to the back, goes to a rear air sac. Then the bird breathes out, but it's not breathing out the air that it's just breathed in. It's breathing out an earlier packet of air when it breathes out, and the packet of air that we are following goes through the lung, right? So it pushes through the lung, even though it's not the air that you're breathing out, okay? Then the next time it breathes in, that packet of air that we are following now moves to the front air sac. That's the anterior air sac. That's the posterior air sac. Okay, so all these air sacs have names. And in fact, there's a whole host of other air sacs as well. I'm just simplifying it such that you get the basic idea. Right, then it breathes out again. And finally, this air comes out through the trachea as it in the normal way. So it's a two-stroke breathing system. It breathes in, breathes out, goes through the lung, breathes in again, goes to the anterior air sac, breathes out again. So it's a two-stroke breathing system. How on earth did that system come about if it had evolved? The in-between creature would have quite a lot of problems changing from one system to another, particularly if I tell you that that there's much more complication even than what I've told you. I've only just given you the tip of the iceberg here. The complications are enormous. The sternum bone that I referred to acts like the action of a set of bellows, okay? You've got to move a bellows to change the pressure, right? You suddenly change the pressure, low pressure, the air comes in, you put the bellows back and it pushes them out again. If you're playing an organ, in the old organ where you had to pump it, that's the same principle, okay? We breathe, at least I hope you're breathing, as I said earlier. We breathe by moving a diaphragm. We move it down and we move it up. Okay, you're doing it instinctively. You've got a muscle going down and a muscle coming up. If you're good at singing, if you're good at speaking, you've got a real control of this diaphragm. Well, there's no diaphragm in a bird. But there is a diaphragm in reptiles. Just a minute. Those people who say that birds came from reptiles, I've got a lot of thinking to do. In fact, this guy was very honest in 1997. He said, this is in Science, 14th of November 1997. Recently, conventional wisdom has held that birds are direct descendants of theropod dinosaurs. That means two-legged creatures. So they think, oh, there may be some similarity between a velociraptor running along the ground and a bird. But it's really very superficial, this argument, because this chap understood some of the problems. However, the apparently steadfast maintenance of hepatic, piston, diaphragmatic lung ventilation in theropods throughout the Mesozoic poses fundamental problems for such a relationship. The earliest stages in the derivation of the avian abdominal air sac system from a diaphragm ventilating ancestor would have necessitated selection for a diaphragmatic hernia in taxa transitional between theropods and birds. Okay, you need a translation, don't you? Even those of us who know a little bit about the science still need a translation. The apparently steadfast maintenance of a hepatic piston diaphragm lung ventilation. In other words, a lung system like we have and a lung system like crocodiles and all other reptiles have today. We actually have a very similar balloon system, right? With a diaphragm going up and down. The fact is that they can see that really all the fossils show that all reptiles always had that. Okay? All the indications are that their skeletons imply that there was no avian lung going on. Some people have tried to argue that there might have been something like it, but you've still got a real problem. Even if there was a creature which had a similar arrangement, which was dinosaur-like, even if there was, because you can't tell everything just from the bones, but even if there was, you'd still have a real difficulty in saying that there was a transition from one to the other. The argument would still apply. Okay? The earliest stages of the derivation of the avian abdominal air sac system would have meant you've got a hernia because you've got a diaphragm, right, which is suddenly disappearing, and you're trying to change it to a sternum bone which has been pushed up and down. You've got a real problem. Such a debilitating condition would have immediately compromised the entire pulmonary ventilatory apparatus and seems unlikely to have been of any selective advantage. You bet. The creature would be dead. So how can you have natural selection operating on a thing which can't breathe? That's basically the issue. You've got a fundamental problem. Because you've got to have a creature which exists if you're going to apply the laws of natural selection. So let's just briefly look at what natural selection is. What is natural selection? Well, natural selection is the natural equivalent of artificial selection. Artificial selection is when you've got a breeder actually wants to breed a certain type of dog. Or he wants to breed a certain type of cow, okay? Let's take dogs for a moment, as they're on the screen. So, supposing we're at Crofts, and we've got some wild dog, and we want to breed a very shaggy dog, okay? We're talking about artificial just for a moment. I'll come back to natural in a moment. I know on the screen it's talking about natural, but I'm imagining myself at Crofts, and I grab this wild dog, and I say, right, I want to breed a shaggy dog, because I like shaggy dogs. Don't know why I do, but you do. Okay? Or else you might want a very small chihuahua. Can't think why anybody wants to take a chihuahua down the high street. There we go. You have to go like this, you know. Here's my little chihuahua. Yeah. Anyway, whatever you want for your dog, right, you've got to breed it. How do you breed it? Well, you take both sexes of a similar type, you know, both got a bit long hair, put them together, hope that they breed, have lots of little ones, and then you say, which one's the more shaggy of the lot? And you take the shaggy ones, and you keep on going until, wow, they've really got long hair. They can't see where they're going. Well, that's just a minor detail. But, you know, so you've got shaggy dogs, okay? That's how you do it artificially. Now, will you get the information for a short-haired dog once you've done that? Chances are that you've just about eliminated that gene from the gene pool of the group that you're now dealing with. Got it? Okay? Now, that's just simple Mendelian genetics, okay? Now, if you apply that to natural selection, it's exactly the same story, except instead of you being the cross manager, you know, trying to breed your dogs, it's actually environmental pressures, ecological pressures. And it's pressures of geographical location. It's pressures of the environment. If you're in Eskimo country, you tend to get long-haired dogs because the short-haired ones actually don't survive so well. Yes, we understand natural selection. Not a problem. Natural selection just simply selects out of what is already there. Natural selection never builds a bridge to bringing something which isn't there already, contrary to what people think. So whether it's dominant or recessive, it will only select what's there. There is just the possibility, as you carry on going, that there is a recessive gene which might just come up. But that, eventually, even that probably, is not going to be there in the ongoing populations. This is just a diagram, just illustrated what I said already, that the Arctic wolf and the Siberian countries tend to have the long-haired dogs, and the African hot countries tend to have wild dogs. If you find another dog, wild dogs which are short-haired, you tend to find that, even though, of course, you get some exceptions when Europeans take a Labrador out there, maybe they can survive for a while. Just say this, that still on natural selection, finches, whether or not this really is an example, by the way, of natural selection, has been debated recently, because people have seen a cyclic behaviour. But just supposing the traditional argument is valid, that actually it's an example of natural selection, I say, well, so what? So on some of the islands, it has favoured finches surviving with rather stronger beaks, because the environmental pressures and the type of food available favours the beaks which go, really get a big nut and crunch it. Whereas on other islands, they don't need that type of beak. So I would say that if it is natural selection, and as I say, there have been recent arguments which have said, well, some of them seem to be changing back to other beak sizes. So it could be that there is some sort of variation going on in the gene pool, which for other reasons is moving back and forth. But if it's natural selection and it's actually eliminating a group, what did they start off as? Finches. What did they finish off as? Finches. It's just simply variation within a kind. Here's another argument people use. They talk about ring speciation. Now, I won't go too long on this because, to be frank, you just need to think hard about this. And for my just expanding it for a minute or so, it probably is sufficient for you to then go away and look it up and then study it in a little bit more detail. However, I will just deal with it just for a few moments because people do raise this. They say, well, we see speciation going on today. And they talk about what's called ring speciation. This is not to do with creatures in the past. It's really to do with creatures today. And they say, look, it's happening in front of our eyes. We've got two species of gulls which won't breed in our own country. Now, the point, of course, I'll give you my answer right at the bottom here. The point is that this is not an example of what's called common descent. No, it's simply an example of gulls, yes, possibly, if you're going to define species as creatures which will only breed with each other, fine, we'll call it speciation. But that doesn't mean that you've actually created a creature which has got more information in it than it had before. You're not busy changing a gull into an eagle. What really is happening is this. As you move eastwards, these dark gulls, which have yellow feet, actually, eventually, they are changing as you go eastwards, and you'll find that the colour is changing. If we were to go the other way, of course, then the same thing applies. I'm just going anti-clockwise. For some reason, I'm going against my arrows, but the same would apply. It doesn't matter. So these girls are actually going with a slightly paler skin as you come round. And then we find that these have pink feet, right? And they're eventually, it's these which we find on the other side of our islands. Now, the point is this. What almost certainly has happened, we'll go clockwise this time, that the original gull kind, right, did have black in its population, but the black ones tended to go off to that side, and the paler ones, for some reason, were blown more to this side, and they were finding new feeding grounds here. They were pretty similar, and they interbreeded. Then others went further west, and they found that actually the variation, the richness in the original ancestral gulls did have information for some with yellow feet. And it's these which have got isolated across the Bering Sea. And these are the ones which dominate in Siberia. Okay, and so it goes on, the same argument going each way. They all interbreed the populations close to each other. But when you finally come round to where we started, they won't breed anymore. All that's happened is that you've got subsets of the original genetic information, which now mean that in that group, you haven't got any more information for breeding the creatures which were in, had the richness of the ancestral pair. And they are so different when you come back again, you find that they don't breed. But you started with gulls. You finish with gulls. All you've got is different types of gulls. You are not actually adding any new information to those gulls. Going to talk about two examples of intricate mechanisms, which is the next stage down. I thought you might like to see your ancestor, but please treat this with care. This is your grandfather, okay? Or sorry, your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather. And if we were to go even further back, please treat this with care. This is going even further back. That probably is an example of an ancestor going even further back. That's according to what evolution says. Now, the one that I first gave out is trilobites. Now, that's what I'm going to look at first. I'm not actually going to look at fish primarily, because the fish, there's another argument on those, although I would note that with the fish fossil, I'm not going to look at that in depth tonight, but do notice that even the scales are visible on that fish fossil, which strongly suggests that the origin of the fossils is not gradual. It is almost certainly catastrophic. It's not my main thesis tonight to talk to you about the fossils, but the fossils actually, from my perspective, fit very well with an argument that they were formed catastrophically, not slowly. But we won't deal with that argument tonight. Let's go right down to the bottom of the fossil-bearing strata. It's not right at the bottom of the whole geological column, which would mean that, according to traditional explanations, I don't agree with the dates, I don't agree with the millions of years. As I've just indicated, I regard the fossils as indicating catastrophe. But just for the sake of argument, I'm going to take those dates as though they were true. Okay, just for the sake of argument. So I'm going to say that the lower ones are supposedly much older than the ones near the top. That means that fish, which generally fairly low down, although there are some notable exceptions, but that the fish are meant to be very, very old fossils. But even beneath those, once you get down to the Cambrian and the Ordovician, which is about 500 million years ago, 400 million years ago, you get trilobites. Now, trilobites are fascinating creatures because trilobites have eyes which are not made of proteins. They're made of calcium carbonate, CaCO3, chemically. Now, I'm going to pass a lump of calcium carbonate, and it's a crystal. And I want you to notice that it has, and I'll put this on the screen so you can see it, It has a double image. Right? This is natural calcium carbonate. So there's a bit of a problem for the trilobite, because if this calcium carbonate was forming according to evolution gradually, then there must have been a lot of squinting trilobites walking around on the bottom of the sea, because they'll be appearing, trying to find their way through the morass of difficulties and predators and all the rest. And what's more, we should see evidence of squinting trilobites in the early rock in the geological column. But we see no such thing. All the trilobites that we find, just want to show you this in the geological column, I'll come back to the other pictures. Oh, this is the geological column. It's not the whole lot, by the way. There's the Hydean and the Arcadian, of course, further down, and I'm aware of that. But this is where all the fossils really begin, according to the traditional explanation geologically. Now, please let me point out again my caveats here. I'm only putting up these dates because they are the classical dates, right? I don't accept them. I maintain that most of these fossils came from the flood, as you could tell from the way I talked about catastrophe. That's my position. But for the sake of argument, I'm just taking those dates and showing you that if these are supposed to be very, very old, which is the traditional view, then we've got a real problem, because these trilobites have eyes which are compound eyes made out of a series of bits of calcite which are not like this. This is natural calcite producing a double image. Let me just explain what goes on in trilobites. There's two possible types of trilobite eyes. These are the eyes of a trilobite in the Cambrian. This is the Ordovician. This is back to the Cambrian again. There are other terms here if people want to go into it in detail. There is actually quite a lot of articles on this. But the basic point is that natural calcite splits the light into two images, and I've just shown you that. There are two ways of getting rid of that double image. One of them is to shape the calcite lens such that it brings it back through special shaping to a sharp image again. That is one way of doing it. The other way of doing it, and this is remarkable, can I have both bits of calcite back? Now this is really stunning. There are some trilobites which have the arrangement that I've just mentioned, which is, you can keep that if you want. There are some trilobites which have the arrangement whereby the calcite is specially shaped. Let me just give you that. They are either using, it's a very similar shape. You either get a Huygens shape or a Descartes shape. These are the two gentlemen in the 1600s 1700s, who actually found that this shape will stop double images occurring, okay? They thought that they discovered something which was new. In fact, only later on did people realize that trilobites already had these shapes, okay? That's one way of doing it. There are other trilobites, though, which have a different method. What they do is that they have one bit of calcite and they have effectively a contact lens. That's one way of looking at it. And if you look end on at these lenses, and remember there's probably a few hundred if not a thousand of these lenses, it's a compound eye, like an eye of a fly, okay? And each one of these is a lens, and it sees things, or used to see things, by seeing the image as a compound image like a fly does, okay? But each of those lenses taken out, because they're not proteins, you can actually, they're still there even in the fossil, right? So you can take them out, put them in the laboratory, shine a laser through it, and you can understand how the eye worked. What has been found is that they have, some of them have double calcite lenses, where there's one crystal that way, and there's one crystal, instead of being that way, it's 180 degrees round that way, and it makes the line come back to being a single image again.
If you'd like to pass that around like that, you'll see that trilobites,
some trilobites, not all, have that eye arrangement. That is remarkable, because this is meant to be a very simple creature. And yet a simple creature shows incredible complexity when it comes to the optics. Meant to be in the Cambrian explosion as very, very simple stuff. But actually, it's a very complicated creature. Just briefly mention dragonflies, then I'm going to end on information. Dragonflies also are something which is showing exquisiteness in the micro design. The reason why I say this is, as you well know, the wings of a dragonfly are so delicate that if you touch them, they will be damaged. Okay? And yet, look at the fossils, which show remarkably that the wings are preserved. That's one thing which is remarkable, which again shows catastrophe. That's not my major argument tonight, but it, by the way, it is interesting to note. But not only the point I want to make is that these are supposedly in the Carboniferous rock, which is a few hundred million years old, okay? And yet, they show identical structure to dragonflies today. Actually, if you watch some of David Attenborough's videos, particularly his DVD on, or DVD, the recent one, not so recent now, but Life in the Undergrowth, he actually speaks about these dragonflies, and he admits that there is no difference between the dragonflies flying in what he calls the Carboniferous swamps and dragonflies flying today. The only difference, he admits, is their size, because they were, a lot of them, a lot larger. So a 320 million year old, supposedly, I don't accept the dates, dragonfly in the Carboniferous shows identical wing structure and the exquisiteness of that wing structure the same as we have today. The evolutionist says that A has changed to B over millions of years, and yet we find that dragonflies, although they tend to appear in this part of the column, are identical to ones that we have today. If evolution is true, how come, and this is just one of many examples, by the way, how come there is case after case after case after case of stasis, that is, creatures which are the same today as in the record, geological record? The main point I'm making at this point, though, is that the exquisiteness of their structures is the same. Okay, we don't have trilobites today. It seems that they are extinct. In passing, just a point before I come to information, the freedom of inquiry. One of the reasons that this debate is very important is because the tactics of the opposition is to close down the debate. May I suggest that that suggests a weakness in their thinking? Because even if we're wrong, why don't we have the debate in our universities? We get it occasionally, but not very often, you'll admit. Doesn't that suggest to you that there is something gone wrong in the debate? Maybe to do with, in fact, presuppositions which are being held with a prejudged attitude which says we will not have a debate because we don't want it, rather than saying we won't have a debate because the guys we think are wrong, or we will have a debate because we know that when the debate takes place, we will be proved to be right. Why is it not had? Very rarely is it had. You see, that's our view of reality, but that's the view of the opponent's view of reality. We, of course, do not ignore the possibility of an outsider, that is, God having made the world. Asked who the designer is, I unashamedly say it's a transcendent God. It doesn't tell me who he is, but it does tell me that there is a transcendent means that that God is not a pantheistic God. He is a God who's separate to his creation. We certainly should not ignore that possibility. It is, in fact, a presupposition if you insist on ignoring that possibility. And it's not an argument from the science. It's actually trying to covertly bring in a presupposition which may well, from the evidence, be proved to be untenable. And that's the position of the creation camp. They would suggest that the evidence strongly is saying that the presupposition that we are just matter and energy is in fact wrong. In 1929, a chap called Watson, not very well known, but he did make this statement, is that the theory of evolution is a theory universally accepted, not because it could be proved by logically coherent evidence to be true, but because the only alternative, special creation, is clearly incredible. Why so? Why make such a statement? To say it's incredible, which means unbelievable. Why? That is, in fact, not a position of science. It's a position of philosophy stroke religion. That, of course, is the position of Professor Dawkins today, the position of Professor Steve Jones, the position of many other atheists. He says biology is the study of complicated things that give the appearance of having been designed for a purpose. Well, you're welcome to have that view, but there is an alternative which fits well with the evidence. Philip Johnson said, if you're going to teach the Darwinist view that organisms may look like they were designed but weren't, then you have to allow for the possibility that they look like they were designed because they weren't designed. That's a very valid position. It's an equally valid position. Who says that the first position is the one that you must take? If the evidence fits better with this position, should we not openly cross the floor of the Commons and say, I'm with the opposition now because the evidence actually supports a different position? That is the genuine way to do science. And what is the motto of the Royal Society? The motto of the Royal Society is nullius in verba, which means that we will not be guided by somebody's statement just because they said it. If we therefore apply the motto of the Royal Society, it was Martin Rees, who's now no longer president, but when he was president, insisted that the only way to regard this debate was to close it down from any idea that the creation position actually had validity. Okay? That was totally against the motto of the Royal Society. The motto of the Royal Society says, let there be debate. Basically, and let it be governed by the evidence. Follow where the evidence leads. And we are refusing to let our education system follow where the evidence leads. We are saying, top down, you must believe this. It's almost Stalinistic, what we are getting today. We're getting, statements from, ex cathedra, from... Okay, they're not really religious people, but they're religious in another sense. They are following a philosophy which says, this is the way to think, and you must think that way. This is flashbacks to the medieval ages. And may I say, have we not got beyond 150 years of so-called statements of evolution saying it's true, when really the evidence hasn't really backed it up? Can we not move beyond Darwinism? We're caught in the past. We need to move on. The evidence is overwhelming now. It's coming up from many disciplines and showing that Darwinism is crumbling. That's what really is happening in the scientific community. But the scientific community, many of them are saying, oh, we don't want to lose our position. Why? Why worry? Let follow where the evidence leads. If you see Mount Rushmore, you see that, of course, wind and erosion over millions of years happens to have carved the faces of Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln and the other two presidents there on that cliffside. You know that happened, don't you? You can see that it's obvious that it was the wind and the erosion over millions of years. Get a life. The evidence is strongly saying that it isn't that way. You might propose that position, but the evidence is strongly telling you otherwise. You have the inference of design. Just a word about machines. Okay, a word about machines. A little cartoon here. The Darwinist cyclist finding his bicycle chain to be of no use at all. Why? Because the links aren't linked up. Now you might think of a number of applications for this cartoon. You might either say that you've got a lot of missing links. That is one way of looking at it, but the way that I'm using it actually is that machinery to be of use has to have everything there. Otherwise, you've got a limping machine which won't work. It might work after a fashion, but it won't work very well. Not unless everything is there. If you take a bicycle and you have a bicycle chain, unless all the links are together, it won't work. You can try cycling with one link missing, but I tell you, you won't get very far, right? A machine needs precision in order to work. That's true also when it comes to living machinery. There is a lot of machinery in living systems, and that machinery has to be precise in order to work. It's particularly true of the DNA, which is in the nucleus in the middle. But it's true actually of all the other parts of the cell, and we haven't put everything in there. Let's just take one of the machines in living systems. This is adenosine triphosphate, which is made, often called ATP, and it's following a particular reaction which is driven by a proton gradient. You can see these H plus atoms schematically in this diagram. Ingredients come in, the food that you eat, and this is whirring at an incredible rate and produces energy. ADP goes in, adenosine diphosphate, and it's turned into ATP, which is important for the energy that you need in every cell. Basically, it's a rotary motor. If you actually to put anything wrongly placed in that motor, it will not do its job. And it's absolutely vital for the systems that we have. Now, machinery needs to be put together according to laws. Now, it's another talk, as I said, and I'm only touching on it here. But it's another talk to show to you that thermodynamically, everything is going the wrong way if you insist that machines came about just by sort of some random process. All the chemistry and the biochemistry says that things go the other way, that everything moves apart, collapses. Just briefly, what you'll find that in that all the machinery, even the machinery where the code is stored, the DNA, all that machinery has what we call in thermodynamics free energy in it. That is, it has raised energy levels. And that naturally, when there is nothing there constraining those bonds to take place, it all just falls apart. It may take a little time to fall apart, but it will eventually fall apart. Now, I could talk to you more on that, but let me just show you the very simple and straightforward point that if you put a frog, try it tonight, in a blender, but I'm being film tonight, so maybe I shouldn't say too much. But you know, if you want to do this in your backyard, but don't tell anybody, put a frog in a blender. You may try eventually to put that frog together again, but you won't do it because you cannot do it without knowing all the blueprint of life to put all those chemicals in the right place. Poor frog, it's dead. And it cannot be put together without intelligence. So really what's going on is that you need information. Coming back to our cell, you need the DNA. The DNA is actually, by the way, it's not the only place where information is stored. Information is stored to a certain extent in the coding part of DNA, but it's recently been found that actually other parts of the DNA thought to be junk are actually carrying information, but in a different capacity. It seems to be to do with the structure. It's actually the geometry which is carrying the information. Let's just talk about the DNA briefly. The DNA carries a bridges across it, and these bridges, three of them together, carry one letter, if you like, or one. We could use different analogies, we could perhaps call it a word, but we usually call the triplet a letter because that letter spells out a particular amino acid. So if we were to look at one in particular, and we were to look at thymine here, and we would look at cytosine there, we've got thymine attached to a cytosine, and that's always the way that it does across the bridge. It will always make that chemical reaction. And similarly, the reverse one there. And at the top here, you'll notice that we've got cytosine, and then we've got actually the next one along. Sorry, that's thymine there. We've got cytosine there, and we've got here, we've got adenine, which is always combining with thymine. So whichever chemical you take on the left, it will have its mirror on the right. And that's important when it comes to the RNA, whether it be the messenger RNA or the transcription RNA, which goes away and actually takes that information and builds a particular amino acid. So here we have an illustration. Here's cytosine, adenine, and thymine. And these are actually a triplet which spells out a particular amino acid. That amino acid we will call amino acid number 2. This arrangement of GGA spells amino acid number 1, and so on. And you'll find that all proteins, that the simplest of them is hundreds, but usually it's thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of amino acids long. If you get one of them wrong, you actually get a real problem. In muscle, the proteins, if they're not arranged in a particular arrangement, then you won't get the right proteins and you'll have some sort of mutation. So these amino acids, it's important that they are in the right order. So what I'm suggesting to you is that we don't just have matter and energy, we have information as the third fundamental quantity. Natural selection always reduces that information base. It doesn't increase it. You could have 10 million or even 10 billion years. You could have 10 billion universes if you wish to go down a multiverse line. But you will not actually increase the information. I had a long argument with a physicist recently who maintained that by interaction with the environment, we could actually change the information base. You can't, friends. All you do is you might reduce information which is already there and adapt it. And so you get a subset of the information, but you won't actually make something which isn't there already. You don't build machines by this method. Because information is not the same as matter or energy. Information on a CD, it's not DNA code, it's some other code. But what is, what's the mass of the information on a CD? You can't measure it by mass. Because if you put the CD in before you put the information on and afterwards, there's no change in the mass. All you've done is redistribute it. You've changed the pattern. And indeed, what's happened is you've imposed a pattern which wasn't there before. It's the pattern of the matter which determines, in this case, the information. The energy levels are basically the same. The energy level of the laser beam shining on the CD, etc., the reflectivity. Okay, it's now slightly different because it's actually seeing aberrations in the laser beam, etc., etc. But you can't attribute an energy level to the information. Actually, there's more in this than meets the eye. Thermodynamically, there is something going on, but I'll leave you to bring that out in questions, and I could perhaps speak on that at another time. But let me just briefly talk about mutations. Can somebody get the cable out of my bag here and attach it? I forgot to put it on. One thing I forgot to do. There's the cable. Could you attach it, please, and just pop it on the back? Thank you. Mutations generally cause loss of information, such as this flightless cormorant living in the Galapagos Islands. No, it's at the back. There. Okay. Is this evolution at work? No, it's loss of information. And it's an example of a mutation. Now let me just briefly deal with mutations. I have a book here, which is called Genetic Entropy and the Mystery of the Genome. I had it here. It's obviously disappeared. Here it is. This book is really worth reading, because John Sanford makes an incredibly important argument here. What I've just been referring to is the fact that information does not increase just by Mendelian genetics. We weren't there talking about mutations. Now I'm talking about mutations because people argue that mutations do give you a means of topping up that genetic pool which is reducing. Professor Dawkins admits in his book, A Devil's Chaplain, that actually it is true that Mendelian genetics will not increase the information base. He accepts that. Natural selection reduces it. You read his chapter Against Us. But he then argues that mutations will do it for you. Actually, there is a thermodynamic argument here which shows that that will never work. Right? There is a number of arguments against his position. But we'll leave that for another time. But let me just show you John Sanford's argument. Because John Sanford shows that actually, if you have mutations, they are always generally deleterious. And this window that he has in Kimura's distribution, which is an important distribution in genetics, which is found experimentally. In other words, this is the frequency of mutations against their effect. If you come out of this box in the middle, you are no longer having a neutral effect. Okay? In other words, there is built into living systems the ability to carry some mutations. Okay? There are some mutations which, well, okay, gives him a funny nose, doesn't matter, you know, or gives him a slight sort of twist, or gives him a squint even, you can survive, right? It's not going to really be a big deal. Actually, if it's a squint, of course, it is felt at the phenotype level. This is the genotype level, but if you come out here, you are affecting things at what we call the phenotype level, right? Now, what he's basically saying is that any favourable mutations never get there. They are never felt. They are always in the neutral zone. But the deleterious ones are felt badly. That's why we have spina bifida. That's why we have other genetic diseases, which actually have a big effect on our population. He uses this illustration of the genotype and the phenotype, like the princess, the famous story of the princess sitting on a massive layers of beds, and underneath the bed at the bottom there's a lot of peas. Is she ever going to feel the peas? No way. Because peas are like the genotype level, and it's only when you get out of the neutral zone, you'd have to have a massive rock here for her to feel what's going on. And that never happens with favourable mutations. How many are there? People have argued 1 or 2 or even 10 per child, or 1 per 3 children. That's what people have said. Actually, it's 100 to 300 per child. That means that every time we have a generation, a large number of mutations take place. Now, I'll tell you what the argument back against us is this. Ah, but they only happen in the junk DNA. There's only a small percentage actually happen in the coding part of the DNA. That is a wrong argument. I'll tell you why. Because recently Nature has shown that actually it's very important. All the DNA is important. So what John Sanford is saying is that the mutations are building up in the human race. And we're almost in genetic meltdown, not quite, but if we carry on for another few tens of generations, we will be in genetic trouble. We won't be able to stop it. Here's the Nature articles that I was referring to. The human genome is an elegant but cryptic store of information. The roughly 3 billion bases encode either directly or indirectly the instructions for synthesizing nearly all the molecules that form each human cell, tissue and organ. Sequencing the human genome provided highly accurate DNA sequences for each of the 24 chromosomes. There's a reason why they say 24 and not 22, which I won't go into now. However, at present, we have an incomplete understanding of the protein coding positions, portions of the genome, and markedly less understanding of both the non-protein coding transcripts and the genomic elements that temporally and spatially regulate gene expression. To understand the human genome and by extension the biological processes it orchestrates and the ways in which its defects can give rise to disease, we need a more transparent view of information it encodes. That's an incredible statement. This was in Nature 447, June 2007. 14th of June, and page 799, if you want to look it up. This is basically saying that the non-coding part of DNA, which was supposedly junk, is not junk. And it's carrying important information. So when all those mutations take place that John Sanford was talking about, it's actually it really is causing trouble. You cannot just say that only a few percent are going to cause trouble. That's the answer to the argument put back to us. And Tim Hubbard from the Sanger Institute says, we are now seeing the majority of the rest of the genome is active to some extent. You can find this at this important website, which is linked with the other article I've just been talking about. In other words, guys, follow where the evidence leads and you find that your presuppositions are not necessarily true. Something is going on here which transcends matter and energy. It's a code. If we have a code, and I saw this on my lava lamp, it might tell me that something was going on if that changed to 23 and 24 and then told me that my time is up. Okay? In other words, the code transcends the matter. Okay? The search for extraterrestrial intelligence is built on that principle, saying that if we actually change things in an ordered way, that will tell people out there that really is intelligence on planet Earth. We might have thought that there wasn't, some of us, but, you know, they might think that there is. And the other point about information is that information has meaning and it uses that code to produce words. Now, this is just two aspects of information. Information has a code, which is neither matter nor energy, and that code is to do with whatever code you have in your language, okay, the alphabet. Sitting on that alphabet is a message which uses that alphabet. Now, John could have said to Mary that he loves her, not by using sand and an English alphabet. He could have used paper, right? And he could have written in Chinese, but Mary wouldn't have understood it, right? And she'd have run a mile. Gibberish to her. But because she understands English, that message has meaning. So what I'm basically saying here, friends, is that information is not the same as matter and energy. Let me end on this point. What defines information? Well, we could have a number of questions here. Is it the DNA? Is it the DNA code used in the molecule? The energy stored in the molecule? There's a number of things you might say is the information. Is it the transcription of RNA, or is it the messenger RNA? You could argue till the cows come home concerning what really is the cause of the information. But if I was to play to you, which I was going to just then, if I was to play to you Chopin's Nocturne, and I was going to ask you the same questions but put relevant to music, is it the musical score? Is it the code used in the score even? Is it the ink? Is it the piano? Is it the keys? Is it the strings of the piano? Is it the acoustics of our ears? Or is it the pianist where the information lies? Where does the information in this music lie? So those are parallel questions to what I'm arguing about the DNA. Is it the DNA molecule? The DNA code? Is it the energy? Is it the DNA polymerase? I could go into all the details. Is it the nucleotide bonds? Is it the amino acids, which I've mentioned? Or is it the messenger RNA, which is doing its stuff from the DNA and taking it to the outside of the cell? Maybe we missed something. Maybe it might just be connected with Chopin. Perhaps we've missed something, guys. Maybe there really is an author of this music. Well, of course there is. And in exactly the same way, Just as we say music doesn't write itself, neither does software write itself. Information systems are not defined by matter and energy. They use them. Information implies intelligence, and intelligence implies a mind. So you say, well, who is the mind? People laugh at us for saying that there is a creator. They can laugh as much as they like. But the information of the music said that there was a composer, and in exactly the same way, the information in DNA says that there is a creator. It's a very valid scientific position. In a lecture in 1847, Faraday, whom we should learn from, said this: our philosophy, whilst it shows us these things, should lead us to think of God, him who has wrought them. Then he quotes Romans chapter 1, for it is said by an authority far above even that which these works, he meant his science, presents, that the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead. The evidence of DNA and the inscription, the coding part of DNA, and now we're finding even the non-coding part, strongly says that information is there, which is nothing to do with the matter and the energy, is to do with the mind of the Creator. I rest my case. You know what's more important? It's knowing who the Creator is. And of course, there I have to move on to the scriptures. You will see that I've been justifying what the Bible says when it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Now, if I move to the Bible, it tells me that that creator is nothing but the Word of God. The Word of God, it says in John's Gospel, became flesh. And it says at the beginning of John's Gospel, all things were made by him. Who is it? It's saying the Lord Jesus Christ is the Logos, the Word. It's hardly surprising then, is it, that we find evidence after evidence after evidence that this same Lord Jesus Christ really did make the world. And the inscription on DNA in particular shows that. I have a booklet here, which is The Relevance of Christianity in the Scientific Age. I want to say to you, if you're interested not just in the creation argument, but interested in knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, according to whom the Bible says is the Word, can I recommend you take this booklet from me? It speaks of this Word, Christ, who became flesh and who died on a cross to take my sins away. That's not been the subject of my talk, but I unashamedly mention it right at the end now. Because although the important thing is, yes, to show to you that there is a creator, I'm also very concerned that you should know how to know him. The Bible says that the way to know this creator is to understand that he came to this world to die on the cross, to take my sins away. And that's what this booklet is about. It's talking about a much greater professor who came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as his own Saviour. He actually was a professor of rheumatoid arthritis at my own university. And as a student, he came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as his own personal Saviour. And it tells you how he just realised how he needed to personally trust Christ, even when he was at Liverpool University. He went up to train as a vet, a fact which he says, and I can hear him saying it now, I never used to tell my patients later on. So I'll tell you this, he was one of the greatest rheumatoid arthritis professors that has ever been. Since the war, he was well known in his field, but he says the greatest thing that happened to him was personally knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, not only as his creator, but as his Saviour.
Thank you for your patience. May God bless you all.